Hey, welcome back to Cool Classics. Today we're going to take a look at the life and career of Alice Pearce, best known for her role of Gladys Kravitz on Bewitched. Yeah, that's right, the nosy neighbor. I was always rooting for her. They made her out to seem crazy, but I knew she wasn't. I seen what she seen. And I got some cool clips, some freaky facts, so here we go. She was born October 16th, 1917 in New York City. Now her father was a foreign banking specialist, which meant the family had to move around, and that meant all throughout Europe. So that started when she was 18 months old. They lived in Brussels, Antwerp, Rome, Paris. Now at the age of 9, she fell off a swing and hurt her chin. She busted it really bad, and it actually left her with an underdeveloped chin. Her family moved back to the United States when she was a teenager. She was then boarded at the Master's School in Dobbs Ferry, New York. She then enrolled at Sarah Lawrence College in Yonkers, New York. And in 1940, she graduated with a degree in drama. She found it pretty hard to find work that first year, so she ended up becoming a comedian and performing in nightclubs for money. This went on for 2 years, but then eventually she was cast as Lucy in the original Broadway production of On the Town, and it ran from 1944 through 1946. That turned out to be her big break, because in the audience one evening was Gene Kelly, and he was so impressed by Alice's performance that when he went to film the movie version in 1949, he requested that she come be in it, and she was the only original cast member to be included.
If on an island we two were cast astray, I'd make it into paradise indeed. Because you'd find that I am all you need. I am all you need. As the dog told the pastry cook.
Man, that was so cool to see. I had no idea about any of that. Now, the year before, in 1948, she married John Rocks. He's a composer, songwriter, mainly for stage and film. But one of his songs, It's a Big, Wide, Wonderful World, was later taken by Buddy Clark all the way to number 25 on the charts. Now, after her fabulous performance in the movie, ABC hired her to put on the Alice Pearce Variety Show. It was on Friday evenings, and this was the very early stages of ABC TV, so there's no footage, not even pictures, and they don't even have a complete list of how many episodes were made. I find the same problem for her next two TV appearances. The Jean Carroll Show in 1953 lasted 6 episodes, and Alice played the neighbor. The same year, she played Annie Mokum in all 6 episodes of the TV series Jamie, which starred Brandon DeWilda, the kid who played Joey in the movie Shane, and he won an Academy Award for that role. But yeah, there's an episode called Love Comes to Annie Mokum, and I'd like to see it, but I guess there's no money in archiving it and uploading it. Heck, I'd have paid $2. I was able to find her in things like Lux Theater and the Goodyear Playhouse, but overall, television really wasn't working out for her just yet. But what did come along was her second big movie, the musical The Belle of New York, starring Fred Astaire and Vera-Ellen. Check this out.
Wanna be naughty? Naughty but nice. See if I'm made of sugar and spice. If I could dance the bunny hug too, suppose a stranger should arrange a tete-a-tete. Not really naughty, just sort of naughty, but nice.
My gosh, that was so good. Now her next movie, The Opposite Sex, was just filled with famous women. June Allison, Joan Collins, Dolores Gray, Ann Sheridan, Ann Miller, Charlotte Greenwood, and guess what? Agnes Moorhead's in there too. Yeah, Endora from Bewitched. Isn't that cool? Shortly after filming that movie, her husband John became very ill and unexpectedly passed away. Alice said this really hurt her. She was devastated and couldn't work for almost 2 years. But when she did return to television, she started to get better roles. Here she is on The Real McCoys, episode Work No More, My Lady.
Emmy, you're the world's worst cook. I never told you before because, well, I didn't want to hurt your feelings.
That's not true. Is it?
You, well.
Would you repeat the question?
Are you suggesting me going off with you on a trip?
On a honeymoon trip.
Honeymoon?
What do you think I come back here for? Will you?
Well, I...
Go ahead, Emmy. He's been waiting 8 years building up for this, that's all.
And here she is on Dobie Gillis, episode, and now a word from our sponsor.
And I promised the warden I'd go straight.
Go straight? I'll thank you not to use such language in the presence of your mother.
I'm sorry, Mom, but I can't go back to that kind of business. Honest.
Honest? Where did you pick up all them nasty words? Rock and roll is dead, but the hot item today is folk singing. Sing that to John, let's go.
My name is Nanish.
Only I ain't Fifi LaVerne no more. Your old lady, bless her heart, changed all that.
Call me Mom, cause a folk singer's gotta have an honest, old-fashioned name.
Meet Prudence Virtue. She ain't gotta fix me, doesn't it, Eddie?
Prudence Virtue?
Yeah, and I taught her how to sing like a Prudence Virtue.
Prudence Virtue?
Call out the dogs and let's go hunting. Got my fella and I'll never let him go. Yes, I got my fella and I'll never let him go.
This canary here, folksy enough?
She's as American as pizza pie.
For my next number...
Oh, not an option. ...is the Shantuzi. Records them songs on an album. The only thing you've got to do is take it around to the disc jockeys. Sprinkle the loot around so they play the album 40, 50 times a day.
Okay, Mom, you win. I'll take another crack at payola.
That's my sonny boy.
What we need is a typical college student with absolutely no brains.
And so, music lovers, we ring down the old curtain on another fascinating old session.
Well, it looks like they found their brainless college student. Now, she was also on an episode of Dennis the Menace called You Go Your Way.
Now, Mr. Bushman used to like a little honey in his coffee. I used to call him Old Sweetie, too.
How long has that been, Esther?
Well, it's been a lot longer than he figured.
That's the way it's been with my Beau Elmer. And when he got excited, his little mustache would twitch.
Well, I wouldn't trust a man with a twitchy mustache. Oh, excuse me.
Hi, Miss Tarbell.
Hi, Dennis.
My grass cut?
Yeah, I'll cut yours too, Miss Tarbell.
Oh, I have an arrangement with a nice gardener, Dennis.
Yeah, I'm trying to make an arrangement with him too.
I think I know what she meant by arrangement. Around this time, Alice started dating Paul Davis, who had been a stage manager with Desilu Productions. Paul had opened a portrait and framing studio called Pesha, and it was frequented by a lot of celebrities. And Alice was hanging out there with him all the time when she wasn't on an audition. They were inseparable. So much so that the two of them got married on September 20th, 1964, and went on a honeymoon and stayed at the Coronado Beach Hotel. 3 days later, while still on their honeymoon, Alice's agent, George Morris, called the hotel and said that Bill Asher and Elizabeth Montgomery would like to speak to you, and I think you might want to take this call. She did, and when talking to them, they said, "We seen your name on a list of availability, and we got a part for you in a show. Our first episode is already aired, but we would love for you to be added to it." Alice then asked, "Well, don't I have to audition?" And Elizabeth said, "Absolutely not, but we need you right now." So Alice turned to her new husband, told him what was happening, and he said, "Honey, if you really want to do this, we could leave right now." And they did. So Alice Pearce joined the cast of Bewitched, and the character of Gladys Kravitz, the nosy neighbor, was born.
Driving the Stevens car. She drove it into the garage.
There's only one strange lady around here, Gladys.
Now, the director William Asher and the star of the show, Elizabeth Montgomery, were also a young married couple. As a matter of fact, Elizabeth had just had their first child, Bill, 21 days before filming the first episode. So when they found out that they interrupted Alice and Paul's honeymoon, it became a big joke between the two couples, and they became really good friends. One morning when Alice came into the studio, she noticed that Elizabeth Montgomery was reading the Hollywood Star newspaper, and she was frowning. And Alice said, "What's wrong, dear?" And Elizabeth handed her the paper. It was an article by a roving reporter, and he said, "Another night on the town, and of course I had to run into that cloy couple, Elizabeth Montgomery and William Asher. I know their affection is just an act." Now, the word cloy means to disgust or sicken someone with an excess of sweetness or sentiment. Alice tore that page out of the paper, wrinkled it into a ball, and threw it towards the trash can. Then she said, "He doesn't even know you two. If he did, he'd know you're the real McCloys." And everybody started laughing, and Elizabeth gave her a big hug.
"There, come take a look, Abner."
"Leave me alone. I'm retired."
"Alone, you said?" "But lovely and green. The hair?" "Yes. And flowers?" "There, aren't they colorful?"
"Abner, the house across the street has got a lawn, and Abner, there are trees and flowers."
"So what do you want from me?"
"That lot was plain, ordinary dirt. Now it's a jungle. Take a look, Abner."
"Gladys, don't pull. Take a spoonful of your medicine."
"I don't need my medicine."
"If there's no trees, you'll take a spoonful?"
"I promise."
"Go get it."
"Well, that's the way it'll look someday."
Now, the whole cast and crew noticed how every day Paul would bring Alice to the set at 6 a.m., come inside and get her settled, then head out and go open up his shop. And around noon, he would close up, show back up at the studio, have lunch with his wife, then head back out and work for a few more hours in the shop, close up for the day, come up to the studio, and wait for Alice to get done. No matter how long it took, they were leaving together and he was always with her. Everyone looked at them as a loving, devoted couple, and they were. Now, when everyone got back together to film the second season, it was very obvious that Alice had lost a lot of weight. So she got everyone together, and she said this: "In May of 1964, I was diagnosed with terminal cancer. We got married, went on a honeymoon, and you called. I took that as a sign. I get to do one more show, and I'm here telling you now, I am very sick, but I want to stay here and work with you for as long as I can." Everyone was shocked and saddened, but they rallied around her and made sure that she was comfortable every time she was on set. Alice ended up appearing in 27 episodes, the last of which was called The Prodigy, and just a couple weeks after filming it, on March 3rd, 1966, at the young age of only 48, she passed away. The cast and crew all decided to save that episode and run it out of order as the season finale on June 9th, along with a tribute to Alice. Later that year, Alice won the Emmy Award for Outstanding Performance by an Actress in a Supporting Role in a Comedy. Her husband Paul was there to accept it. He said that every day when he would show up to have lunch with her, he was also giving her her medicine, and he still had hope that some miracle would happen. Over the next couple years, Paul said that he was not just in mourning, he was also in depression. He even let his business fall apart. There's an article online called "Liz Montgomery Saved My Life," and in it he speaks how her and Bill Asher would come by and try and build him up and get him back on his feet. They did everything in their power, he said, to get me going again. They even let me come in and direct 2 episodes of Bewitched. A week before she passed away, she told her husband Paul, "I have been keeping a journal since the day I was first diagnosed. In there, I write daily affirmations, how I'm feeling, things that are happening with my body. Those are for doctors to look at. Maybe they can help the next person. I also tell thoughts and things that might help someone else who is in the same situation. So make sure that people know about this." Here are a couple quotes from the journal. "I feel the progress of the disease. In my case, it is unusual. Because of my mental attitude, I am a supremely happy woman. I have never been beautiful, but I have been blessed with a rich career and the love of 2 fine men. The strength I have found in the devotion of my dear Paul is beyond measure." Wow, another amazing story. And what a sweetheart of a person. Did you see her in those musicals? I swear, that's fabulous work. She was good. Now, I don't want to leave this video on a downer note, so we'll play a clip from Disorderly Orderly with Jerry Lewis.
"Said push on, boy. Oh, didn't you hear me? Push on, orderly. Well, what's the matter with you? You look sick."
"Oh, my.
Well, don't dilly-dally. Push on. Push, push. Yes. Mush, mush."
I hope you enjoyed this video, and if you did, please give it a thumbs up and subscribe to the channel. I make these in my spare time for fun. I watch old movies and television shows in the evening to help relax me. They ease my anxiety. And then I come on here and I share what I learn with you when I look them up, because I always get caught up in the characters and take a deep dive. Cool classics.